In today's class, we will discuss fixed axis rotation of a rigid body. So, first of all, let us understand these terms. What is meant by a rigid body first? Okay. So, the idea of a rigid body is that the distance between any two particles of the body remains constant. Okay. For example, suppose we have a body of any arbitrary shape. Suppose this is the ith particle and this is the jth particle on the body. Then the distance between these two particles is rij, let us say. Okay. So this is a rigid body if rij is equal to constant for any two particles I and j. Okay, so in a body, if the distance between any two particles remains constant, then it is called a rigid body. Okay, so the shape of the rigid body does not change as it moves. Okay, since the distance between particles remains constant, when a rigid body moves, its shape does not change. For example, consider your book, a book, okay, or a stone. Okay, when it moves, the distance between any two particles in it does not change, so it's a rigid body, a stone or a book. So its shape also does not change as it moves. So that is about rigid body. Next, let us consider what is meant by this term, fixed axis rotation. Okay. So, if the direction of the axis of rotation is always along the same line, okay, suppose a body undergoes rotation about an axis, and if the direction of the axis of rotation is always along the same line, then it's called a fixed axis rotation. Okay, here the axis itself may undergo translation, but its direction of the axis of rotation is always along the same line. This is the idea of fixed axis rotation. Consider an example. Consider the motion of a car along a straight line. Okay, a car is moving along a straight line. Then look at the rotation of the wheels of the car. Okay, so if the car is moving along a straight line, the car wheel, a car wheel attached to an axle undergoes fixed axis rotation as long as the car drives along the straight line. Okay, because if it's a straight line, the car wheel is rotating about the axle, and this axle is the direction of this axle is along the same line. See, remember that the axle itself is undergoes translation, but its direction remains the same. Okay. As long as the car moves along a straight road. Suppose the car turns a curve. Okay. Then this axle, the direction of this axle changes. It rotates around a vertical axis. Okay, so the motion is when it turns around along a curve, the motion is no longer fixed axis rotation. Okay, so for fixed axis rotation, we can keep this picture, a car moving along a straight line. The rotation of the wheel is fixed axis rotation because always the axle is, the direction of the axle is perpendicular to this direction of motion of the car, we can say. Okay. So the direction of the axis of rotation is always the same, but the axis itself can undergo translation, as in the case of the motion of the axle or the wheel of a car. Okay, so now we have understood these two points: rigid body. What is a rigid body? A body in which the distance between any two particles remains constant. Then as the body moves, the shape does not change. Then what is fixed axis rotation? Rotation about an axis whose direction remains along the same line, even though the axis itself may be undergoing translation. Okay, so let us consider the fixed axis rotation of a rigid body, and we assume that during this fixed axis rotation, this axis of rotation will be along the z direction. Okay, that does not cause any loss of generality, because you consider the rotation of a rigid body about some fixed axis, and we can always assume that we can always choose our coordinate system in such a way that the direction of this axis lies along the z-axis. Okay. So when a rigid body rotates around a fixed axis, okay, every particle in the body remains at a fixed distance from the axis. Is this clear? Consider a rigid body rotating about a fixed axis. Suppose the fixed axis is along the z direction. So the rigid body is rotating about this fixed axis. Then remember that for a rigid body, the distance between any two particles remains constant. And for the fixed axis rotation, the direction of the axis of rotation is always along the same direction. In this case, along the z direction. Then it means that when a rigid body is rotating about a fixed axis, every particle in this body remains at a fixed distance from the axis. Okay. Now let us try to calculate, let us try to get an expression for the angular momentum LZ, okay, of a rigid body during a fixed axis rotation. Okay, we assume that the direction of the axis of rotation is about the Z direction, right? So let us try to calculate this angular momentum along the Z direction for a rigid body. Okay, so let us choose a coordinate system with its origin on the fixed axis. Okay, so let me draw this like this. This is the Z axis. X, Y, and Z. Okay, so I have chosen the origin of the coordinate system at the fixed axis. Okay, this is our axis of rotation, okay, which is directed along the z-axis, and here we have chosen the coordinate system in such a way that its origin is on the fixed axis. Okay, now imagine that a rigid body is rotating about this z-axis. Now let me consider one particle of this rigid body. Okay, let us say its mass is mj. Okay, it is at a distance, let us say rj from the origin. This is the position vector of the particle mj, particle of mass mj, the jth particle. Okay, about the origin. Okay, now if we consider any other particle, every such particle on the rigid body, it's at a fixed distance from the axis. Okay, in other words, the magnitude of this rj, okay, magnitude of the position vector remains constant for every particle of the rigid body. This is clear, okay, because as the body moves, every particle of the body is fixed, right? The distance between any two particles does not change. So every particle is something like a fixed particle. So that means if we choose an origin, every particle, as the body rotates, every particle of the body, okay, is at a fixed distance from the origin. Okay. That is, magnitude of this position vector of every particle remains constant as the body rotates. Now, how this can be possible? Okay, how is it possible that this body rotates about the z-axis in such a way that the magnitude of the position vector of every particle of the body remains constant? Okay, so if we look at this, consider only one particle, okay, jth particle. This is the position vector of the jth particle from the origin of the coordinate system, and its magnitude should remain constant as the body rotates about the this z-axis. Why do we say that the magnitude should remain constant? Because this is a fixed axis. The axis does not change. Its direction is always along the z-direction, and the particle is not moving. Okay. Once suppose the body is stationary, then this is the position vector of the particle. Rj is the position vector of the particle. Okay, and since it's a rigid body, this position vector is not changing. Okay, and even when the body rotates about the z-axis, the magnitude of this position vector should remain same. Now, how is it possible that a vector can change as the body rotates? This vector will change with time, but its magnitude should remain constant. How is it possible? This is possible only if the rate of change of this vector with respect to time, okay, that is this quantity drj by dt, rate of change of this position vector with respect to time, should be perpendicular to rj. If the change in a vector with respect to time is perpendicular to that vector itself, then it means that the magnitude of the vector remains same, only the direction will change. In other words, this vector will be rotating about an axis. Here, the rigid body is rotating about the z-axis. So, each position vector of each particle of the rigid body is rotating about the z-axis. Okay. So, we are considering only one particle now. We will generalize to all the particles a little later. So, for this particle, for the magnitude of this the position vector should change during rotation, but the magnitude should not change also, since it's a rigid body. So, the only possibility is that the rate of change of position vector with respect to time should be perpendicular to rj. In other words, we can say that this point or this particle will be executing a circular motion about the z-axis, such that the rate of change of rj with respect to time will be tangential to this circular path. Okay, let us say, okay, if I draw like this, it may get the impression that it's along the same direction. Let us consider this. So this is the direction of vj. Drj by dt is nothing but vj. So we can say the velocity should be perpendicular to the position vector. Velocity is perpendicular to position vector. So that is possible only if this vector is rotating about the z-axis. In other words, this vector traces a circular path around the z-axis. Okay, so let me also draw the perpendicular distance of the jth particle from the axis of rotation. Okay, this is the perpendicular distance of the jth particle from the axis of rotation. Let me call it rho j. Okay, so rho j is the perpendicular distance of this jth particle from the axis of rotation. Okay. So let us try to obtain a relationship between different quantities. So first of all, the magnitude of this linear velocity of this particle, this is equal to magnitude of drj by dt. Okay. So how do we calculate this? So let me draw it here. Let us draw this circle, this circular path here. Suppose we are looking from above. This is a circular path traced by the position vector rj. Okay. This is the center of the circle. Suppose initially the jth particle is here. Okay. So this is position vector perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. This point we are looking down through the axis of rotation. Okay. This is the axis of rotation. And rho j is the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. Now, within a small interval of time delta t, let us say this traces a distance delta rj tangential to this circular path. So, this is the new position vector. This is the new distance, and this does not change. Perpendicular distance remains the same. And this angle traced during the time delta t is, let us say, delta theta. Then you get the result that delta rj is equal to the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation rho j into delta theta, because rho j is now the radius of the circular path. So arc length is equal to radius into angle. So let us divide both sides with the delta t. So delta rj by delta t is rho j into delta theta by delta t. Now in the limiting case, delta t tends to 0, okay, the equation will be like this. Okay, rho j into delta theta by delta t. Now this left hand side, this limiting quantity is nothing but rate of change of rj with respect to time. Okay, and that's equal to rho j is a constant, d theta by dt. Okay, so I can write it here. The magnitude of the velocity we can write as rho j into d theta by dt. And this d theta by dt, this quantity is the rate of rotation. Okay, it's also called the angular speed omega. So we have this relation, magnitude of the linear velocity is equal to perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation, that is rho j, which is also the radius of the circular path, okay, radius of the circular path, and into angular velocity. So linear velocity is equal to radius, in the case of a circular motion we can write linear velocity is equal to radius into angular velocity. So in the previous class, during the discussion of the discussion of angular momentum of a conical pendulum about the reference point B, okay, I have both reference point A and B, I have used this relation, V is equal to R omega, where V is the linear velocity, R is the radius of the circular path, and omega is angular velocity. And now we see how this emerges, how this relation comes. Okay. So the magnitude of linear velocity is equal to perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation into angular velocity omega. Okay. And this angular velocity is simply rate of rotation, rate of change of angle with respect to time. And here, what is the difference between these two quantities, rho j and rj? Rho j is actually, see, this circle here, the circle traced by this our jth particle, okay? This circle is in the xy plane, right? It's perpendicular to the z axis. So, rho j is the perpendicular distance from the z axis to the point j, jth particle, okay? So this rho j is nothing but the position vector of the, position vector of the jth particle in the xy plane. So we can write xj square plus yj square. This is rho j. It's a perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. Okay. Whereas rj, the magnitude of RJ, we can say, okay, it is nothing but root of xj square plus yj square plus zj square. It is the magnitude of the position vector from the origin, distance from the origin. So that's the difference between these two quantities. Rho j is the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation in the xy plane, which is lying in the xy plane, and rj is the distance of the jth particle from the origin. Okay. Okay, so let's now turn to the angular momentum of the jth particle. Okay, so we can say angular momentum of this particle is Lj is equal to R cross P or Rj cross Mj Vj, where Vj is the linear velocity. Okay, now let us consider, this is the angular momentum of the jth particle. Now let's consider the z component of the angular momentum of the jth particle. So we are interested in the z component of the angular momentum. Okay. Remember again that our rigid body is rotating about a fixed axis, and the fixed axis is directed along the z direction. So we are interested in the z component of the angular momentum for this jth particle. So we can use this notation L j comma 0. So j stands for the jth particle, z stands for the z component. Okay, how do we do this? So we are taking only the one component, so it's a scalar quantity. So how do we calculate this? From the previous class, I think from the second class, we have discussed that if you take one component, let's say z component, how do we do this? Take the magnitude of linear momentum mj into vj into perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. Okay, so perpendicular distance to z axis. This is it. It's a scalar quantity, this is not a cross product. So magnitude of the linear momentum mj into vj, okay, mj into vj into perpendicular distance to z axis. Okay, so what is the perpendicular distance to z axis from here, from the figure for this jth particle? See, the perpendicular distance to the z axis is nothing but rho j, right? So we can write this as mj vj into rho j. But again, just we have obtained that Vj, we can, the magnitude of Vj we can write as rho j into omega. So let me substitute that here. This is rho j into omega. Again, another rho j is here. So there are two rho j. So we have mj rho j square omega. Okay. So this is the z component of the angular momentum of the jth particle. So what is the z component of the total angular momentum of the body? Let us use the symbol LZ for that. So this is obtained if you sum over all the particles. Okay, sum over j. J represents the number of particles. Lj, Z. So Lj(Z) is the angular momentum of the z component of the angular momentum of the jth particle. If you sum over all the particles, so this summation is over all the particles of the body, then what do you get? You get the total z component of the angular momentum of the total rigid body. Okay, so let us substitute that. So we have Lz is equal to summation over j mj rho j square omega. So this is the expression for the z component of angular momentum of a rigid body undergoing a fixed axis rotation along where the axis of rotation is along the z direction. Okay, here let us see that we have used the same value of angular momentum for all the particles. Okay, when we sum over j, Okay, we have used mj rho j square omega for different particles. Mj will be different for different particles. As j varies, mass can vary. And of course, as j varies, as the particle varies, the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation will vary. But omega remains the same, does not vary with the particle. Why? We have taken angular velocity to be the same for all the particles of the rigid body. Why? Because it's a rigid body. Okay, because the particles remain fixed at different positions. So the idea is that angular velocity is the same for all particles of the rigid body. That's why we have used the same value of omega for all the particles. Okay. Now let us consider a related, very related concept called moment of inertia. This expression that we have just now written, okay, Lz is equal to summation over all the particles into mj mass of the jth particle rho j square, perpendicular distance of the jth particle from the axis of rotation into omega, angular velocity. This expression we can rewrite as Lz is equal to some I into omega, okay, where this I, quantity I, is, if you look at the previous equation, it is summation over j mj rho j square. Okay, so what is this quantity? You can look at, let us look at this quantity. It depends upon two factors. One is the mass of the jth particle, second, perpendicular distance of the jth particle from the axis of rotation, square of that perpendicular distance. So this means that this quantity is entirely a geometrical quantity. Okay, it depends on how this rho j varies with mj, how the perpendicular distance of the particle varies with its mass. For when you go to different particles, how the perpendicular distance varies with mass. In other words, it depends only on how mass of a body is distributed with respect to the axis of rotation. How the mass of a body is distributed with respect to axis of rotation. What is the distance of each particle from the axis of rotation? So this is a geometrical quantity, and this quantity is called moment of inertia of the body. Moment of inertia of the body. Okay. Okay, so we have this relation L is equal to I omega. Angular momentum is equal to moment of inertia into angular velocity. Okay. Now this relation is in rotational motion. Okay, this relation is closely connected to, or we can say analogous to, a similar relation in translational motion. In translational motion, we have an expression, linear momentum is equal to mass into linear velocity. Okay, here instead of linear momentum, okay, in translational motion, we have angular momentum. In rotational motion, instead of linear velocity v, we have angular velocity omega. So instead of mass m in translational motion, we have moment of inertia I in rotational motion. Okay, so the moment of inertia in rotational motion plays the same role of mass in translational motion. So what is this quantity, moment of inertia? It depends upon when a body rotates about a fixed axis, this moment of inertia of the body is a geometrical quantity. It depends upon how, look at this, how the mass of the body is distributed from the, about the axis of rotation. Okay, how the mass of each particle, or how the perpendicular distance of each particle varies with its mass. Okay, now, so since even though we have developed this expression for z component of the angular momentum of the rigid body as well as moment of inertia of the rigid body in terms of summation of our different particles. When we consider actual realistic situation of a rigid body, the number of particles is it's not countable. In other words, the mass is not discretely distributed about a rigid body. It is continuous distribution. So mass is continuously distributed about the in a rigid body. Okay, so in a continuous distribution of mass, we have to change this expression for moment of inertia from summation to integration. Okay, so how do we do this? In a continuous distribution of mass, this quantity summation over j mj rho j square, this will change to summation goes to integration. Okay, so instead of rho 1 square, rho 2 square, etc., we cannot count each particle. So we simply take a continuous quantity rho square, and instead of m1, m2, m3, etc., we can take a differential mass dm. Okay, so what is this rho? Rho is the perpendicular distance or from the axis of rotation for the differential mass dm. Okay, so differential mass means a mass of a small element, that we a small lump that we consider in the rigid body. Okay, so this is how we do that. Instead of summation, we have to do it as an integration. Okay. Then what is the so the expression for moment of inertia we can rewrite as integral rho square dm, where the integration is over the entire rigid body. Okay. So this rho is again in the xy plane, so we can say that this we can rewrite as integral x square plus y square, because the fixed axis is along the z direction, so perpendicular distance is in the xy plane, so x square plus y square, integral x square plus y square into dm. Okay, now this expression we can modify into different special cases. Okay, we can consider three special cases. Okay, one is let us consider one-dimensional bodies. That means one-dimensional means it's let us say the length is very large compared to breadth and thickness, or let us say length is very large compared to area of cross section. So only one dimension is significant. Examples of such bodies are a ring or a rod. Okay, a very a thin ring or a long rod. Okay, a thin ring. Okay, so in these cases, this differential mass we can write as mass per unit length lambda into a differential length dl. Okay, where lambda is lambda is mass per unit length. So in such cases, moment of inertia you can write as integral rho square. Instead of dm, I can write lambda dl. So it's a line integral, integration along a line, integration along the length of the ring or length of the rod. That's the case with one-dimensional body. So instead of dm in the general expression, I have substituted lambda dl, and the integration is along a line. Okay. Now a second possibility is two-dimensional bodies. Example: a disk or a shell. Okay. Here the differential mass we can write as sigma into dA, where sigma is mass per unit area and dA is the area element. So moment of inertia we can write as integral rho square instead of dm, I can write sigma dA. So it's an area integral, it's a double integral, okay, integration over a surface of this disk or surface of the shell. Now the third possibility is consider a three dimensional bodies, example a sphere. So here dm you can write as some mass per unit volume into differential volume dv. So this w, quantity w, is mass per unit volume. Okay, this is nothing but the density. Mass per unit volume means density or mass density. Usually we use the symbol rho for that, but already we have used rho for perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. That's why we are using a differential notation w. So what is moment of inertia here? Integral rho square, instead of dm we are writing w dv. So integration is over the volume of the body, so it's a triple integral. Okay, this is a surface integral, this is a volume integral. So this is how we can calculate moment of inertia of a rigid body. So in general it is integral rho square dm, depending upon whether its nature of its dimension, whether it's a one dimensional body like a thin ring or a rod, long rod, then it's a line integral. If it is a two dimensional body like a disc or a shell, it's a surface integral. If it's a three dimensional body like a sphere or a cylinder, then it's a volume integral. Okay, so this is the idea of the moment of inertia, angular momentum of a rigid body, angular momentum for the fixed axis rotation of a rigid body, and how we can express angular momentum in terms of moment of inertia. Right, we can write angular momentum as the set component of angular momentum as I into omega. And this expression, we have seen that this expression in rotational motion, L is equal to I omega, this is analogous to P equal to mv in translational motion. So we have also considered in this case the geometrical quantity, moment of inertia of the rigid body, which is identical to mass in the case of translational motion. And the different ways to calculate moment of inertia of a body is like this, depending upon the distribution of mass of the body. So in the next class, we will consider some particular examples. In fact, we will consider these specific examples of a few one-dimensional bodies like a thin ring or a rod, two-dimensional bodies like a disc and shell, and three-dimensional body like sphere, and how we can calculate moment of inertia in each case about different axes of rotation. That's all.